Good morning and happy Sabbath. I felt like a school teacher when I said that, but happy Sabbath, church. Today we're going to continue with the theme for this quarter, which is the mothers and the fathers of the faith. I'm just going to say a prayer because I need it. Dear Heavenly Father God, as I stand here as your vessel, I pray that no one sees me. May they just see and hear you. Amen. It was the late 90s, and I had almost just busted my head open trying to do a Janet Jackson move. Now, you must be wondering, why is Pastor Lolly talking about Janet Jackson on the Sabbath? Let me explain to you why. That summer, I had gone to my cousin's house, and she was a massive Janet Jackson fan, and she allowed me to watch all of her videos. And so when I got home, I wanted to do all the moves. And so guess what I tried to do? I did this particular move. Janet Jackson gets a chair, and she stands on the chair. Then she stands on the back of the chair, and the chair glides down magically, and then she does a somersault. Simple, right? Sounds very simple. Well, of course it wasn't simple, and that's exactly why I almost busted my head open on my mum's glass table in her front room. All because Janet had become my icon. I wanted to be like her. I wanted to be fearless like her. And I didn't have the gymnastic ability like she did. But for her, for me, she represented a great image. But there was one thing stopping me, and that was my mother. She is a Seventh-day Adventist Christian mother. And no child of hers was going to represent anything of Janet Jackson from the 90s. Like every other teenager, I was going to get my clothes from Tammy Girl and CNA. Does anyone else know what I'm talking about? Growing up, we all have icons. People we base our image on and who we want to reflect. Whether you were inspired as a child through flicking through Jackie magazine of the 70s, I know some of you read Jackie magazine, or maybe you read Just 17 in the 80s, or maybe you read Smash It magazines and Right On from the 90s, and for those of you who are a lot younger than I am, maybe you flick through YouTube and you watch Patricia Bright and Tanya Burr. Most of you have no idea who I'm talking about, but there are young people here who do. And Olajide and Zoella, they are the new fames of this generation. And whilst all of this seems harmless when you're younger, there is a possibility that we limit our potential and we become just mere reflections of the people that we were created to be, and we just become reflections of the society around us. If we never fully understand who we are as human beings through the lens of an intentional creator God, through the narrative of Genesis 1, specifically Genesis 1, 26 to 28, you can grow up to become an adult reflecting a false image, far from God's intentions that he had for human beings made in his image. It's becoming clearer to me that there is something wrong with our society. The awareness that we have a unique value and a unique purpose has been lost. That's why so many people ask the question, why am I here? They are lost with fear, lost with anxiety, and huge amount of stress. It is said that the single biggest killer of men in the UK under 45 is suicide. Shocking, right? Young men are taking their lives because of the symptoms of feeling totally worthless and totally hopeless, unable to speak to anyone about it. One in five young people between the ages of 16 and 19 suffer with anxiety linked to self-worth and stress. There are so many statistics out there, and it's clear that mental health is becoming a real issue across all demographics. I have an inclination that what we are experiencing as a society today is linked to us becoming an image of something that we were never meant to be. Humans have been reduced to robots that are only created to work and produce products and services to be consumed. Humans have been reduced to sexual objects, simply created to be consumed by swiping left or right for one's pleasure. Humans have been reduced to consumers, only created to buy, 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 and buy. The image of humanity is changing, and it is causing us severe pain and severe suffering, more than God ever intended for us to carry. And whether we are believers, whether you're hanging on to faith by a thread, whether you're already declared an agnostic or an atheist, the truth is all of us know that something isn't quite right about what's happening in humanity. Surely we were made for more. And the answer is yes. But we can only really answer this when we know what make and model we are. So today we're going to do just that. We're going to unpack Genesis 1, the verses that we read in the scripture reading, and we're going to look at one particular word. So are you with me? I'm going to need you to get your Bibles out because we're going to spend some time in there. And young people, if you've got a notebook, a pen or a highlighter, I really recommend you get it out as well, because you're going to want to maybe make, if you like my Bible, I've got loads of notes in it, loads of highlighting in it. Maybe you want to make some notes. Let's discover together as a community of believers what God wants to reveal to us today. So let's turn again and let's narrow it down and look at Genesis 1, verse 27. Genesis 1, verse 27. Yes, I can hear Bibles flapping and screens swishing. Amazing. Genesis 1, verses 27. And doing this means you'll stay awake. So it's a bit of a trick. Genesis 1, verses 27. God created Hachadam. That's what it says in the Hebrew. God created Hachadam in his own image. Male and female, he created them. The Bible declares right in Genesis 1:27 that God created man. The word here is ha-chadam. Do you want to try and say that? I've been practicing all week. Ha, like ha-ha-ha, ha-chadam. Amazing. This is what the word is in Hebrew. And it means a man, or humanity, depending on the context, which is different to Chadam, a specific man called Adam. Don't you just love Hebrew? So simple yet confusing. Let's turn our Bibles to Genesis 5, verses 1 to 2, and you can see how the Hebrew works in context. Genesis 5, verses 1 to 2. Genesis 5, verses 1 to 2. You've got it. This is the book of generations of Adam. I'm reading for the King James Version. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God, he made him. Male and female, he created them and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. Clearly, Adam is used three ways in this verse. You have Adam, the proper noun. This is the book of the generations of Adam, a specific man called Adam. And then it says, in the likeness of God, he made him. Male and female, he created them and called their name Hachadam. This is it used in a different context, meaning humanity. Male and female, he created them. So going back to the original text, Genesis 1, verses 26, God made humankind in his own image. Male and female, he made in his own image. But is it really saying, but what is it really saying here? Martin Luther, the reformer, said that if he could understand the first two sentences of the Lord's Prayer as Christ did, then the rest of his life would fall into place. What Luther observes is that it's really easy to read God's word, but it's much harder to grasp its reality. So what is the reality of what this verse is trying to tell us? Is the text simply saying that we physically look like God? Sure, I mean, some of you are very attractive. But I don't think that is the point of verse 27. This isn't the word of God making a scientific statement in the first instance, defining for us the physical form of God, Elohim. This is the word of God doing what the word of God always does. And that is making a theological statement. Not what is God, but who is God and how do we relate to him? What does it mean for humanity to be made in God's image? If you were Moses, hearing this account for the first time, what would you have understood when the Bible says you are man, humankind, made in the image of God? The ancient world believed that an image carried the essence of what it represented. For example, if there was an idol image of a deity, the people would worship that image because they believed it carried the essence of the God that it represented. They didn't believe that the deity's image could do what the deity did, nor did they think that the image looked like the deity exactly, but that the deity's work could be accomplished through the image, that the deity's work could be accomplished through the image. Being made in the image of God in the ancient world, or how Moses would have understood it, means partnering with God to accomplish the work of God. And this is exactly what we see when we look at the text that follows. In verse 28, following when it says, he made them in his image, God blessed them, and then God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and every living thing that moves upon the earth. God commands humanity to create more humans. And then he says, look after them and also the animals. Why did God tell them to be fruitful and multiply? Couldn't God, after Sabbath, and then Sunday on Monday, just start again and create some more human beings? Surely he could have. Adam and Eve would have been pottering around the garden and just gone behind a bush, and next thing you know, there's Jane and Peter. But no, that's not what God did. God decided that he would allow humanity to be partners with him in creating more idols, creating life, filling the earth with more images of God. Sorry, I said idols, I meant images. Then in verse 28, it continues, God says to them, be caretakers, protectors of every living thing on earth. Again, God could have found someone else to do this. He could have said, okay, I've created human beings, and I'm going to look after them. I'm going to make them plates of food. I'm going to pick the grapes from the tree. I'm going to dig the carrots out. But no, God says, you know what? I am going to allow you to look after the earth that I have created, handing his responsibility over to humanity, or partnering with humanity to accomplish his work in the earth. The image of God is not as much to do with the physical, mental, or even spiritual likeness we have to God. And sure, that is true in some way. Ellen G. White says in Education, I think it's page 15, when she talks about the fact that we are representations of God, and that God in his fullness, triune God, Jesus is a human, and we are also humans, and we have our particular faculties. But the image of God language in Genesis is much more dynamic. It speaks more directly to human purpose and human function and human vocation. Humans were given permission to create life and a vocation to look after all living creatures. God on the seventh day stopped working, but his work didn't stop. He used human beings as a vessel through which he would continue his work. We are not just meant to be representations of the society around us. We were meant to be used for much more. So let's see if we can dig a little bit deeper together and unpack this word image just a bit more to see if I'm really or we are really on the right path. In the Hebrew, the word for image is tselem, and it's also the word dimut. Image and likeness, they're synonyms. When we directly translate this word into the ancient Greek language, which we find in the Septuagint, we get an even more precise and beautiful understanding of what God is trying to communicate to us. The word in the Greek for image is ikon. And Anna, I hope I'm saying it right. Ikon. Does that sound like any other word that we have in the English language? Icons. Ikon, icons, a person or a thing that is a representative symbol. The word of God is trying to communicate to us when it says made in the image of God, that humans were made as icons of God, icons of God. We are representations of God in the world, God's ambassadors on earth. That blows my mind. And how exactly this is seen even more clearly when we look at what God says and what happens to Adam when he's put in the garden in chapter 2. So if you turn with me to Genesis 2 verse 15, we'll see exactly what God means when he says we are representations of him or we are ambassadors of him on the earth. Genesis 2 verse 15, and I'm reading from the NRSV. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to till it and keep it. To till it and keep it. These words, if you were Moses or one of the children of Israel, would have jumped out of you, out at you. This language, till it and keep it, avad and shema in the Hebrew, are exactly the same words that are used in Numbers when God is directing what the priests should do in the temple. Turn with me to Numbers 3, verse 8 and 9. I don't think any of you have a Hebrew scroll, so I'm going to read it out for you. But turn to Numbers 3, verses 8 to 9. This is the tabernacle being created and the priestly duties are being given. And maybe make notes if you can't move around your Bible now and look at this later for yourselves. I'm going to read it. Numbers 3, verses 8 to 9. They shall be in charge, speaking about the priests, of all the furnishings of the tent of meeting and attend to the duties for the Israelites as they do service at the tabernacle. You shall give the Levites to Aaron and his descendants. They are unreservedly given to him from among the Israelites. The words that should stand out or would have standed out if you understood Hebrew would be charge and service. They are exactly the same words as till and keep it in the Hebrew, avad and shema. These words aren't just there for the sake of it in Genesis. It's there because it's trying to tell us something about what it means to be a human ambassador, about what it means to be an icon of God. We are icons of God because we are, or humanity has, the potential to be priests and ambassadors of God. And in Exodus 19, verse 6, you guys will know this very well. It says this, "Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my commandment covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole world is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." This is God speaking to humanity, or speaking to the people of God specifically, that they are a priestly kingdom. To be humankind, to be humankind is to be a representative, an ambassador, a priest on behalf of the people, a holy nation. Let's just pause for a minute and think. What impact should it make to us on how we live today? knowing that we are created with the potential to be ambassadors for God and a priestly people. This fills me with a huge sense of responsibility. I don't know about you, but it fills me with a huge sense of responsibility that as a human, I was originally and primarily created to be an image bearer of God, to be God's representative here on earth, that through my life, people should be able to see who God really is, that like a priest, I should be able to advocate on behalf of my friends and family, bringing others to know and see God for themselves. How does it change things for you? Does it change anything? Am I meant to conduct my life in a way in which God's reputation is enhanced on this planet? This is brilliantly summed up in 1 John 4, verse 12. In 1 John 4, verse 12, it says this, and you will know it. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made perfect in us. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made perfect in us. John got it completely. He totally understands what it means to be an icon of God. No one has ever seen God, right? Have you seen God, physically seen God? But when we display God's love towards one another, we perfect, the Bible says, God's love. How can humans make God's love more perfect? Is John saying that somehow God's love is imperfect? No, that's not what John is saying. When the word translates into the English language, the better word would probably be completed or fulfilled. That by the way that we love one another, God's love is fulfilled in society. That through us, God's love is perfected in society. This is exactly what it means to be human, what it means to be an icon of God. This is humanity's ultimate purpose, to be vessels of God's love to the world. And if you thought that we had dug as deep as we could go with this word image, I'm about to geek out completely. So let me have the moment. This word is the gift that keeps on giving. This word image, icon. Icon in the Greek language means not just an image, but actually a mirror image. A mirror image is the clearest representation you can have of yourself, isn't it? Unfortunately, when you look in the mirror, you're like, ah, is that how I really look? Does anyone else have that in the morning? It's just me, okay. Someone laughing really loud, yes. But it is the truest, most clearest representation you can have on yourself, have of yourself. And so what an icon is essentially a mirror. An icon is a mirror. Who here did physics at school or remembers physics at school? No? No one? I really wish Sister Atkinson was here because she knows physics, right? But maybe I can jog your memory. And Sister Atkinson, if you're watching this, I'm sorry if I get it really wrong. So, a mirror. My hand is a mirror. Just imagine for a minute. When light hits a mirror, what direction does it go? Does it bounce and then it bounces straight back to the direction it came? Yes or no? No. Okay, we're on the same page. No, it doesn't. When the light hits the mirror, it goes in at the angle of reflection and then it bounces out at the angle of incidence. Did anyone else get that? I looked it on Google earlier. Don't worry, I don't remember from school. So a light hits the mirror and then it bounces out at a different direction. So if God is saying that we are icons, that we are mirrors, when God's light hits us, when God's love hits us, when God's blessings hit us, it doesn't just go straight back to God, it goes out towards others. And I feel like this icon language that we miss because it just says image in our English language is so deep and so meaningful that as ambassadors and as representatives of God on this earth, we are mirrors. And when God speaks to Abraham, he says, I'm blessing you so that you could be a blessing to others, right? That's essentially what it's saying. You're a mirror. I'm blessing you so that you can bless others. Sorry, my hair just went all like that. But it's so powerful what God is saying, that we are icons, that we are meant to see God face to face. And when we see him face to face, we reflect that love, we reflect that blessing, we reflect that out to the rest of humanity. Ellen White says this in the Council on Stewardship. The Lord calls upon every one of his children to let heaven's light, the light of his own unselfish love, shine out amid the darkness of this degenerate age. This word icon, this word icon, this word image is truly the gift that keeps on giving. This is why, my friends, the account of Adam's creation is so important. It sets the foundation of why we created and for what purpose. We are not merely robots. That's exactly why God created the Sabbath, way before the fall. Yes, it's good to work. It's necessary to work. But rest and balance is so important. Sabbath helps us reflect God's image more clearly. We are not merely sexual objects. That is why marriage was created. A protected union where communication and respect and compassion can grow, so that relations, as my auntie calls it, isn't just about you or what you can get, but it is really about selfless love. Marriage helps us reflect God more clearly. And we're not merely consumers. That is why we are invited to co-create and be caretakers. That is why God blesses us, so that we can bless others. Service helps us reflect God's image more clearly. Trust me on this one. When we deep down acknowledge and believe that we are Hachadam, humankind made in the image of God, with a purpose and a clear vocation, the restoration begins. Augustine, a Roman African and the 4th century theologian, says this: we are created for God. Our hearts are restless until we find him. We are created for God. Our hearts are restless until we find him. If I were allowed to change this slightly, I know he's the 4th century theological giant, but if I was to change it slightly, I would say this: we are created in God's image, and we are painfully lost when we are unable to see him clearly enough to be his icons. You know, the truth is this: we are cracked icons. Sin and shame came into the world, as Genesis clearly depicts, and we are no longer in the garden. We are no longer in the intimate presence of God. We are not able to access him as we once could have accessed him. We're not face to face with him. And therefore, as icons, the reflection is a little bit dull. But we still have been given a second chance to be what God had always intended for us. The Christian goal, as people of God, is to recapture what it means to be made in his image. And there is no clearer example than the example set by Jesus Christ. When we get to the New Testament, Paul says this all the time. And I just, as I close, want us to look at, just read these few verses. Romans 8, verses 28. Again, I'm reading from the NRSV. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that we might be the firstborns within a large family. Even though we are cracked images because of sin, because of Jesus, we are called to be conformed to the image of him, so that it's possible to be images and icons again. In 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17 to 18, it reaffirms it for us again. Now the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Does this crystallize it for you a little bit more? We once had veiled faces because of sin, unable to see God, unable to reflect God. But now through Jesus, we have unveiled faces and we are able to be transformed by his image. This is what it means to be an icon of God. But there's something that we need to bear in mind. There's something that we need to bear in mind if we really want to be transformed by the Spirit into the image of Jesus Christ. It says in Colossians 3, verses 5 to 11, and this is the last verse that I'll leave us with. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passions, evil desire, and greed, all of which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all these things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another. See that you have stripped off the old self with its practices, and you have clothed yourself with the new self of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, which is being renewed in the knowledge according to the image. Circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian and Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all in all. Church family, we are Chachadam, humankind, made in the image of God with a clear purpose and a clear vocation for this planet. Amen. Amen.